الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. إن شاء الله today will be finishing first aspect from the aspect of al-jahiliyyah, from the explanation of Sheikh Salih bin Fawzan al-Fawzan, may Allah preserve him. And the reason the Sheikh Salih al-Fawzan حفظه الله تعالى, he went into the detail to explain this aspect because this is the most dangerous of them all. This is the most dangerous of them all, that the people of Jahiliyyah, from among the idolaters and the people of the book and those who were upon shirk and al-kufr, they fell into a shirk. They fell into shirk. So that's why the Sheikh, Sheikh al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah, he started with the most serious and the most dangerous aspect of the aspect of Jahiliyyah. And when you look at it, you find out that any society cannot be built except upon Tawheed. Except upon Tawheed. So it is upon the du'at, those who call to Tawheed, is to start with Tawheed first, before anything else. Before the affairs of Salat and Zakat and other than that, we have to tackle the problem of shirk. Because shirk is the worst of all sins and the greatest of all sins. And that's why the Shaykh, the author, rahimahullah, Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, he started with this aspect, which is a shirk, which is shirk in al-ibadah. That the mushrikeen, they use intermediaries in their dua. When they call upon Allah, they used intermediaries, Allat wal-Uzza wa Manat. Likewise, the grave worshippers, they use intermediaries as well. They use al-Awliya wal-Salihin, Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jailani, Ahmed al-Badawi, and other than them. So that's why the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he started with it. And also the commentator, Sheikh Salih bin Fawzan al-Fawzan, he went into detail to explain it. So the Sheikh, he said, therefore, one must have loyalty towards Allah, His Messenger, and the believers. And this loyalty against disbelief and the disbelievers and shirk and the polytheists. This is what Tawheed is all about. Because, Ikhwan, a person cannot be a muwahid. He cannot be upon Tawheed if he gives loyalty to the kuffar and the mushrikeen. And he attends their celebration. When they celebrate shirk, he attends their celebration. This person will not be a muwahid. And unless he frees himself from shirk wal-mushrikeen wal-kufr wal-kafirin, and also al-mulhideen, those who are atheists and the like. And we can also include in this the people of bid'ah. The people of bid'ah. Especially the heads, the leaders of the people of bid'ah. We must have enmity towards them. And hatred towards them. Until they leave their bid'ah. And they come to the sunnah. How about when someone is upon shirk and kufr, is even worse. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned the condition of Ibrahim alayhi salam and those who were with him from the believers. So they said to their people, kafarna bikum wa bada baynana wa baynakum al-adawatu wal-baghda'u abadan hatta tu'minu billahi wahda. We have rejected you
And there has appeared between us and you enmity and hatred forever until you believe in Allah alone. Surah Al-Mumtahina. This was by way of Ibrahim. May the peace and blessing of Allah be upon him. See, this is the way of Ibrahim. This is the methodology that Ibrahim was upon, alayhi salam, and those believers were with him. They were upon Tawheed. And they showed enmity to their people who were upon shirk. They rejected their shirk, their ibadah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and there has appeared between us and you enmity and hatred forever until you believe in Allah alone. As long as you're not believing in Allah, we are your enemies. We have nothing to do with you. This was the way of Ibrahim. May the peace and blessing of Allah be upon him. As for those who call today for an open dialogue and understanding between the religions, claiming that they are all heavenly faith, rather some are even so bold as to claim that the Jews and the Christians are not disbelievers, then this is contrary to what the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with, contrary to what is stated in the Quran, and contrary to the religion of Ibrahim, which we were commanded to follow. So the Shaykh is referring, Ikhwan, to the da'wah of Ikhwan al-Muflisin. The da'wah of Ikhwan al-Muflisin, and it's widespread. They call it Abrahamic faith. Or if you wish, they call it interfaith dialogue. Interfaith dialogue. And it is all over the Muslim world. It's all over the Muslim world where they will bring like a Christian priest. They will bring a Hindu priest. They will bring a rabbi, a Jewish rabbi. And they bring one of the imams or so-called shuyukh of Ikhwan al-Muflisin. And they will have a dialogue. They will say, let's all come to a common term. We are all heavenly, this is all heavenly faith. This is where we are upon the religion of Ibrahim. But this is all kadib, lies. This is all kadib. It's all lies. Because this individual, Ikhwan, as Sheikh Saleh Fawzan mentioned, they wanted to combine between the lizard and the whale. They wanted to combine between the lizard and the whale. And the lizard live in the land. Right? The lizard lives in the land and the whales lives in the ocean. So how can you bring them together? It's not going to happen. Likewise, you cannot bring a tawheed wa shirk together. Wal iman wal kufr. They cannot come together. There is no way that you can combine between al kufr wal iman wa tawheed wa shirk. So those who say La ilaha illallah, are they the same as those who believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the sun or the light or other blasphemous statement? They cannot be the same. They cannot be the same. So this da'wah is a false da'wah and has evil consequences. Has evil consequences. Because when you compromise your aqidah, then the people are going to turn around and say, oh, the Muslims are the same, like the Jews and the Christians and the Hindus and all that. We are all the same. We all worship one ilah. But the reality is something else. The reality is something else. And this call also weakens al-wala wal-bara. Weakens al-wala wal-bara, loyalty and disloyalty. And also this call weakens the Muslims, especially the youth, the young people. Because when they see this thing, this call to unity, the unity of religions, interfaith dialogue, Abrahamic faith, let them call it what they want to call it. So when they attend this gathering, they get confused. Now they're going to start doubting. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ They're going to start doubting. And if anyone says, we should hate the enemies of Islam, we should hate the mushrikeen and kuffar and the like, they're going to start defending them because they have been brainwashed. You see how dangerous it is. And they're going to start accepting them, accepting their belief. And you don't be surprised to hear, as the Sheikh mentioned, that they would say they're not kuffar. And then they will enter al-Jannah. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ This is all coming from that evil call of Wahdat al-Adiyan, unity of religion, interfaith dialogue, or they call it Abrahamic faith. So we have to stay away from that, and we have to warn the people against this da'wah of Ikhwan al-Muflisin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّوَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّخِذُوا آبَاءَكُمْ وَإِخْوَانَكُمْ وَأَوْلِيَاءَ إِنِ اسْتَحَبُّوا الْكُفْرَ عَنِ الْإِيمَانِ وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّهُمْ مِنْكُمْ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ Oh, you who believe, do not take your fathers and your brothers as supporters if they prefer disbelief over faith. And whoever of you does so, means whoever of you takes them as awliya, as supporters, then he is one of the wrongdoers. He is one of the wrongdoers. Surah Tawbah, ayah 23. The Sheikh said, this individual said that Jews and the Christians are people of the scripture. And they are people who believe. All of these are religions sent from Allah. We will try to understand what we share in common. Yes, this is exactly what they say. And work together. And you should not deem the Jews and the Christians as disbelievers. You see how dangerous it is? This call is prevalent nowadays. Naam. Yes, yes. What they do actually here in the US, Ikhwan al-Muflisin, they do this in synagogue. They do this in the Jewish synagogue. I wouldn't be surprised that they go to the church as well and do it there. And they even take Muslim kids, Muslim children. They have buses that they take Muslim children to the synagogue, to the Jewish synagogue, because they want to brainwash these kids to accept this. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ Accept this. Then where is الْوَلَاءُ وَالْبَرَاءُ? Where is الْوَلَاءُ وَالْبَرَاءُ? So, are you going to tell me that all of these religions are true? Then, you're not looking at what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ الْعَلِيِّ الْعَظِيمِ طيب. The Sheikh said this call is prevalent nowadays. And it eradicates the aspect of loyalty and disloyalty between the believers and the disbelievers. Yes, that's exactly what's going on today. Whoever does not believe in the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a disbeliever, regardless of whether he is from the people of the scripture or not. So, like the Jews, they don't believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the Messenger of Allah, then they're kuffar. The Christians, they don't believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the Messenger of Allah and the seal of all Prophet Messenger, then they are kuffar. They are kuffar. Ikhwan Muslimin, they say no. Don't say they're kuffar. They're the people of the book. Yes, they are the people of the book, but they did not follow what's even in their book. After they changed it, they did not follow what they even changed, let alone other things. Are they they're going to follow what is in the Quran? It's not going to happen. Then what's the point of getting with them and having an interfaith dialogue? What's the point behind it? We have not heard a single rabbi that accepted Islam because of this call, or a Christian priest or a Hindu pundit. We have not heard any one of them that came to Islam through this interfaith dialogue. The Sheikh said, regardless of whether he is from the people of the scripture or not, This is because after the advent of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, everyone has no choice but to believe in him. So whoever does not believe in him is a disbeliever. The Jews and the Christians do not believe in the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they are disbelievers. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, by the one in whose hand is my soul. Is my soul. Means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By the one in whose hand is the soul of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There is no one from this ummah, whether he is a Jewish or a Christian, that hears about me and then dies without believing in what I was sent with, except that he will be from the inhabitants of the hellfire. So the Prophet ﷺ, he made it clear. So this is reported by Imam Muslim, rahimahullah ta'ala. So whoever hears about the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ from this ummah, means all of the ummah, all the people. Anyone who hears about him. And today, everything, alhamdulillah, is accessible. You have the social media. Things are out there. They heard about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam many times. So they have no excuse. So if they hear about him, and the da'wah of Islam came to them, and they rejected it, then they will be among the dwellers of the hellfire. The Sheikh, he said, so after the advent of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, no one is allowed to abandon following his religion. This is such that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, by Allah, if my brother Musa alayhi salam were alive, he would have no choice but to follow me. Look at that. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was alive, he would have no other choice but to follow Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because the revelation that was revealed to him is the seal of all the revelation and scriptures, Quran, and he is the seal of all prophet and messengers sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So after the advent of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there is no correct religion except the religion of Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَن يَبْتَغِي غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَن يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ وَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. And whoever seeks other than Islam as a religion, then it will never be accepted from him. And in the hereafter, he will be from among the losers. Surah Ali Imran. So this is a false call. So he's talking about interfaith dialogue and all that. But yet today, there are conferences and seminars held for its sake. And money is donated at this event in order to call to the unifications of the religion. How can you combine between these religions? How can you do that? How can you combine between al-kufr wal-iman wal-shirk wal-tawheed? The Sheikh, he said, which they call interfaith dialogues, far removed is Allah from this. Can there be such a thing as an open dialogue between belief and disbelief, between shirk and tawheed, between the enemies of Allah and his allies? Then the author, may Allah mercy upon him, said, and it is for this purpose the jihad was legislated. Allah says, the meaning of which, and fight them, means the disbelievers, until there is no more fitna, evil, disbelief left, and the religion is for Allah alone. We are obligated to abide by these three things with respect to the disbelievers. First, to have enmity towards them. This is since they are enemies of Allah and enemies of his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we have to have enmity towards them. The Sheikh, he said, second, to call them to believe in and follow the messenger of Allah. This is something that is obligatory upon the Muslims. So we have to call them. We have to call them to Islam. We have to call them to believe in the Prophet of Islam alayhi salatu wa sallam. Third, to fight against them. They are called to Islam and refuse to accept it. In this case, it is obligatory to wage jihad and fight against them. Allah says, وَقَاتِلُوهُمْ حتى لا تكون فتنة ويكون الدين كله لله. And fight them. And fight them, disbelievers, until there is no more fitna left. And the religion is for Allah alone. So the last stage with regard to them is that of fighting against them. But this is on the condition that the Muslims have the ability to fight. So it's not chaotic. This affair is not chaotic. Anybody can go and kill. No, and fight them. No. We have to have a Muslim leader. We have to have a Muslim leader. So we have to follow certain guidelines. Has to be a Muslim leader, and the Muslims, they have the ability to fight them. They have the ability to fight them. Allah says, فَاقْتُلُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ حَيْتُ وَجَدْتُمُوهُمْ وَخُدُوهُمْ وَحْصُرُوهُمْ وَقْعُدُوا لَهُمْ كُلَّ مَرْسَدٍ. Then kill the polytheists, the mushrikeen, wherever you find them, and capture them, and besiege them, and prepare for them, and prepare for them each and every ambush. Surah At-Tawbah. This ayah contains in it the wisdom behind jihad in Islam. And it is that through it, shirk will be put to an end. So the shirk is eradicated. That's it. And this should be the intention behind jihad fi sabilillah. Not to just gain wealth, gain the dunya, you want a seat, you want this, you want that. No. You're doing it for the sake of Allah, because you want to raise kalimat Allah, kalimat al-tawheed, kalimat al-tawheed, the word of tawheed, and you want Islam to be predominant. The Sheikh, he said, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, he mentioned, the Sheikh mentioned the ayah, until there is no more fitna. What is meant by fitna here? Shirk. So therefore, this verse means, and fight the disbelievers until there is no more shirk present. And the religion is for Allah alone. This is the objective behind jihad. The objective behind jihad is not to expand one's reign of authority, or to conquer kingdoms, or to attain wealth. This is not the objective behind jihad. The true objective behind jihad is to raise the word of Allah and to remove shirk from the land. This is the objective behind jihad. Likewise, the objective behind jihad in Islam is not to defend, or as some feeble-minded writers say today, they claim Islam does not command us to fight against the disbelievers, since this is barbarity. However, the fighting which is mentioned in Islam is for the purpose of defense. This means that if someone transgresses against us, we have to fight against him in order to repel the transgression only. Far removed and perfect is Allah from all defects. Allah Almighty says, فَاقْتُلُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ, then kill the mushrikeen. Surah At-Tawbah. And he says, وَقَاتِلُوهُمْ حَتَّى لَا تَكُونَ فِتْنَةٌ وَيَكُونَ الدِّينُ كُلُّهُ لِلَّهِ. Fight them until there is no more fitna, and the religion is for Allah alone. Surah Al-Anfal, Ayah 39. The purpose and the objective behind fighting is Islam, in Islam, is to spread the call to Islam, to propagate the religion, and to eradicate shirk, and fight them until there is no more fitna, i.e. shirk. And the religion is for Allah alone. Surah Anfal, Ayah 39. This is the objective behind jihad. Fighting in Islam is of two types. The first type, defensive fighting, when the Muslims are able to do it. When the Muslims are able to do it. Second one, offensive fighting, when the Muslims are strong and have the ability to do it. And that's why, ikhwan, knowledge must be sought from the correct source. You have to take knowledge from the correct source, not those who are emotionally motivating, like Anwar al-Awlaki, the Khariji, or Yusuf Estes, or Al-Nu'man Ali Khan, or Umar Suleiman, or the like of these speakers, because they are emotionally motivating, but they are dangerous. They call you to misguidance. So stay away from these individuals. Take knowledge from the like of Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan al-Fawzan, Sheikh Abdul Aziz bin Ibaz, Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, Sheikh Rabi' bin Hadi al-Madkhali, Hafidhahullah, Sheikh Ubayd bin Abdullah al-Jabiri,
الشيخ صالح بن محمد اللحيدان، الشيخ عبد الله بن غديان، الشيخ عبد الله البخاري and other than them from the seniors and the student of knowledge, and also from the student of knowledge who are in the Western countries like the UK, like Sheikh Abu Khadija Abdul Wahid, Sheikh Bilal Davis, Sheikh Amjad Rafiq Abu Iyad, Sheikh Abu Mu'ad Taqweem, Sheikh Abu Idris in the US also, Sheikh Abu Al-Abbas Musa Richardson, Sheikh Hassan Al-Somali, Sheikh Abu Muhammad Al-Maghribi, الشيخ حمزة عبد الرزاق، الشيخ أنور رايت، الشيخ أبو حسن مالك الأخضر، الأستاذ رشيد باربي، الأستاذ رحابات، الأستاذ جميل فينش، الأستاذ عمر كوين، and those who are like them. We ask Allah سبحانه وتعالى to grant us all العلم النافع والعمل الصالح. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم.
جزاكم الله خيرا يا شيخ الفاضل. I'm really happy today you're able to make yourself the dua. الحمد لله we can stick on the phone. جزاكم الله خيرا. وإياكم وإياكم. There are some few questions that came to you. نعم. First one says, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
The dua after one wajib from ruku, hamdan kathiran tayyiban mubarakun fi, is this authentic? Barakallahu fi.
Wa fikum barakallah. A dua that you say when the imam said sami'a Allahu liman hamida, and you say rabbana lakal hamd, rabban kathiran, hamdan kathiran tayyiban mubarakun fi, this is authentic. Barakallahu fi.
Now the same question says, is eating or drinking permissible while standing? Barakallahu fiqh.
The drinking and while you are standing or eating where you're standing is makruh, is disliked. It is disliked. So it is better for a person to sit down, eat and drink.
Jazakallah khair. The next question says, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
The zikr balut rosary, is it accepted by Allah, keeping in mind that it's negate mutabaha?
Repeat the question again, sorry.
That the zikr balut this tasbih.
Misbaha, okay.
Yeah, misbah. Is it accepted by Allah? Barakallahu fiqh.
Naam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَمَا أَتَكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُدُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. He said, whatever the messenger of Allah brings you from Allah, you comply with it. Whatever he commands you to stay away from, you stay away from. And the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the way he used to make his adhkar, he did not use the dhikr beads. He did not use the beads. Nor did he use the pebbles. Rather, he used sallallahu alayhi wasallam his fingers. He used his fingers sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So, if someone did not know, there is no sin upon him. Sheikh Al-Albani said, the dhikr bead is bid'ah. Is bid'ah. And he said, if there was no other evil thing in it, except it kills a sunnah, because when you use the dhikr bead, you're not going to use your fingers. But if you did not know and you used to do dhikr with the dhikr beads, inshallah you will be rewarded. But once you know it is bid'ah, do not use it. Use your fingers.
Is it permissible to sew modest clothes for females that are not wearing jilbab, especially one's family? Barakallahu fikum.
It is permissible to sew. You're talking about the male or female?
Female.
Females.
Those who don't wear jilbab.
Naam, it is permissible to for a sister to sew for other sisters, jilbabs, abayas, and other than that, alhamdulillah, there is no problem.
The next question is, is it upon me to focus on family first before outside is during giving da'wah of Salafiyya? For it keeps coming to my mind that I find it easier to influence my friends than my family. So which of these should I begin giving da'wah to first?
Your family, you start with your family first. Your family comes first, before anyone else. You start with your family. If they are receptive and they accept your da'wah, alhamdulillah, this is good. But if they're stubborn and they don't accept your da'wah, you can keep giving them da'wah, but at the same time, you can focus on other on other people.
The next question says, Hayyakum
Allah. Allah Hayyak.
Please, how do you correct those that have little or no knowledge about Salafiyya when they err?
Those who don't know Salafiyya because they err, the reason being because they don't know manhaj. They don't know the manhaj, the Salafi manhaj. So you correct them by teaching them. By teaching them. You tell them, you show them. You show them like the, like for example, if they made an error, for example, by sitting with the people of bid'ah, let's just give an example. You tell them, Akhi, this is not permissible for you to do this. And I know you may have good intention, but this is wrong what you did. And you show him from the books of the A'imma, like the Sunnah of Imam Ahmed, Sharh al-Sunnah lil-Barbahari, al-Sharia lil-Ajurri, the statement of the ulama, Sheikh Rabi', Sheikh Awid al-Jabri, Sheikh Salih al-Fuzan, and others, and you show him, you see, look, from the principle of the Salafi manhaj, that we don't sit with Ahlul Bidah. So don't do this again. So they need to be taught. Now,
the next person says, what is the ruling on naming one's child Jibril?
Jibril. From what I know, it is not permissible to name a child Jibril because someone might curse him or something like that. And it's like they're cursing Jibril alayhi salam. So it is better not to name a child Jibril.
Now, the last question, Sheikh. The question is, during these days, there has been trials and fit and tribulations in our country, Nigeria, by an operation from Hanabiyye and other than them from the people of desires, such that the sisters upon Salafiyya are becoming much weaker due to this operation. What do you advise us in order to gain steadfast upon this visit of Salafiyya?
Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala rasulillah, amma ba'd. I advise the brothers and sisters who are upon Salafiyya to stay connected with the Salafis in other areas, like the Salafis in the UK, the Salafis in the US, the Salafis in India, in Pakistan, in other areas of the Muslim world. And I advise them to be patient, because this is a trial for you. This is a trial. And you're going to be tested. You're going to be tested. The road is not paved with the roses. You're going to be harmed. You're going to be ridiculed. You're going to be harassed. So stand your ground and be patient. Be patient. And I advise the brothers and sisters to seek knowledge and to study at-tawheed. Study at-tawheed. Study the principles of the Salafi manhaj. That way you're firm. Because when you're firm, inshallah ta'ala, even if al-fitan comes, they will not shake you up, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. You will be firm, inshallah ta'ala. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant you tawfiq wa sadad.
Amen. Jazakum Allah khairan, shaykhan.
Wa iyyakum, wa iyyakum, wa faqakum Allah. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.